Which is the worst Final Fantasy game? Don't say 13 yet, or maybe 15. Who knows?
Nope.
This is the worst Final Fantasy game, according to Metacritic, that is. Final Fantasy All the Bravest is a mobile game that was quote-unquote insulting to play, a cash grab with no gameplay, and to exploit nostalgia. And some of the best user scores are actually trolls. Yeah, that guy is a troll, obviously. You can't get a sequel out of a game where you mindlessly swap your finger up and down. You can't get juice out of a stone. You need an orange for that.
Hello there.
Exactly. But what about the other Final Fantasy games? Are they really that far behind? Lally-ho to you, fair little Moogle. Today I'd like to review 5 of the worst Final Fantasy games according to Metacritic. You know Metacritic? Quality review, right? Well, I'll be focusing on a few games and I'll try to determine why they receive such poor feedback from critics and users. Please note that it's not necessarily my opinion, that I looked up all the review and user scores and tried to get the 5 quote-unquote worst Final Fantasy games, or how you can ruin your Valentine's Day. It's not that they're bad, well except you, but rather that they didn't get a score as high as the others, and actually the problem not even stems from the game itself, well except you, don't be mad at me. If for some reason you don't agree, you're welcome to share your opinion in the comment section below. Okay, let's do it. Number 5. Final Fantasy XIII on PC. If Final Fantasy XIII did well on PS3 and Xbox 360, the PC port was a big letdown. Yes, the world of Final Fantasy XIII is linear. Yes, the story can be overly cringeworthy dramatic, but it's not the real problem. The PC port was just a shoddy version of an already very divisive game. The first time I played, I was unable to watch the opening cutscene because it was lagging so much, I thought I was looking at a PowerPoint presentation.
I kill you!
Some users reported the game was filled with bugs, bad textures, and slowdowns. Most of these annoyances were fixed by a fan-made patch, but it's not in the version you will buy. How is that even possible, I wonder? The lack of basic options to fill with the graphical settings, the fact that the keybinds didn't make sense to me, and playing in 720p was upsetting. So as a PC player, I can tell this port was really disappointing when I can actually play it.
Oh! Yelling doesn't fix it. It's called interference.
13 is far from the worst game in the series. It's not Final Fantasy XIII, but Final Fantasy TARDIS because it's bigger in the inside. One of the best parts of it is being able to create new paradigms to strategize the combat part, make it more exciting, but the game was very restrictive after the last two installments. The inability to control the other two characters in your squad, the fact that if your leader dies you're out, or that some battles require a single strategy to be won, or that it's all about staggering to deal more damage. Every single time. All of that is part of the gameplay, so it's up to personal preference I guess, but the poor PC optimization didn't help. And you reap what you sow. Number 4. Final Fantasy II on PSP. How many times have I heard that Final Fantasy II was a bad game? I wonder. Final Fantasy II is a decent entry in the saga. For some perspective, the iOS version got a 73 and the Game Boy Advance version got a 79. And in both cases, the average user score did better than the average review score, except for the PSP release. So what happened? Well, the pricing on this port was simply too high for a game that in the past had been released on two other consoles, respectively the GBA and the PlayStation. And in both instances, the game was bundled with the original Final Fantasy, which meant that for the price of the game, you were actually buying two, but not with the PSP version. No, it was nothing but a cosmetic enhancement of an already existing port. FF2 might have a weird leveling system. The game is actually quite fun and challenging. It's very open, right from the start, and you may or may not choose to power level your characters, and there's no need to beat yourself up over it, as the legend goes. But I guess that will be the topic of another video. Number 3. Final Fantasy IV – The After Years. Now there's a weird entry in the saga. The After Years is actually a sequel to the original game that was initially released for the Wii. Is this why the Wii got a slightly better score than all the other versions? Probably yes, but there's nothing to write home about. It's hard to compare the two versions in fact. The iOS version was decent in that it was a 3D remake along the lines of FF4, save for the final boss. The 3D port was horrible, seriously. It looks like a Goldin on steroids. But the port is not the problem. The real problem is that the game was just a rehash of the original. There's a few things that are new like group attacks and lunar cycles. And there's a few twists. But 90% of the game is just you doing the exact same things as in FF4, except you start from scratch.
Well,
shit.
The price tag is way too steep for a game like this, especially when you know the PC version suffers from an unstable frame rate, no voiceover, and lots of content cut.
So long, PC Master Race.
What the RTS added in terms of story wasn't worth it. The cost didn't match the gain, in other words. I won't call it a sham, but it was certainly a very disappointing sequel. And in spite of all the love I've got for FF4, I was never able to get into it. Maybe if I wait another 17 years. Number 2. Final Fantasy VII, Dirge of Cerberus, on PS2. Okay, now it's time to tackle the big ones. Dirge of Cerberus is a PS2 exclusive spin-off to Final Fantasy VII. Obviously, so what went wrong? Everybody knows how difficult it is to say anything even remotely nasty about the Seventh Reich, but can we all at least agree that Dirge of Cerberus was more average than the others in the Meta series?
Looks like I'm not the only one here.
The idea of showcasing Vincent in an action shooter was, well, original, and I'm sure that some people like it. After all, the story is interesting and there's a decent amount of fan service. Now listen, I'm not saying the game isn't fun, but what do you expect when you play your Final Fantasy game? Well, certainly not that. There were good ideas and pretty decent cutscenes, but they were coupled with a slack implementation and repetitive gameplay. It's like FF7 and Castlevania spent a drunken night and had a baby together. It's like you're going to buy a Tomb Raider game and find yourself playing some kind of Uncharted ripoff. Oh gosh. Well, at least game companies have understood how to capitalize on your nostalgia. The soft power of nostalgia is perfect for cash cows, and Final Fantasy VII has done a lot,
what?
And it's still going on. You gotta press the juice out of this orange. But Dirge of Cerberus? Nah, let's say it was the weakest entry in the Meta series. Maybe next time we'll have an FPS with Irvine from FF8, except you have to miss the targets to rack up your score. Maybe then I'll be a good player.
You suck.
Number 1. Final Fantasy XIV. Final Fantasy XIV is one of the best games I've ever played, and I'm sure that many people will agree that Shadowbringers was a complete blast. But if you never tried it, you may not be aware that things were very different when the game launched in 2010. Final Fantasy XIV 1.0 had a great potential, but many issues. The interface was sluggish, the chat system primitive, there was no auction house, limited search functions, no key remapping on PC, no markers for quests, animations were slow, you couldn't jump, and the camera locked while encumbered. The game was supposed to usher in the next generation of MMOs, but instead it felt like a game from over 10 years earlier, with modern graphics. Because yeah, the game was pure graphics. It was so beautiful that it's a meme now.
But does it still look pretty?
Most of the design decisions were obsolete, like no progress was made since Final Fantasy XI in 2002. I mean, I like Final Fantasy XI. There were some annoying quirks, but it's understandable for a game that's nearly 20 years old. But imagine if you took all that's annoying in 11 and put that in a modern MMO.
Nope.
FF14 was supposed to be a revolution, but it did miss the boat, and fell short of expectations. The original launch was so catastrophic that the game was shut down. Players were complaining and Squeenie was like, "Players! Adjust!" Now I'm sure that 1.0 still has a supportive community, that you will find people to say, "Make Eorzea great," and copy-paste assets again, burning Lalafels in hope for a better future.
Delicious.
It's true that 14 has become a bit like WoW, but this was a necessary evil, and that's wrong actually. If you target a too narrow audience, don't expect to conquer the market. Nothing surprising here. At this point, this is no longer Final Fantasy 14, but Final Fantasy 13. Just kidding, ish. I could go on for hours about other games that didn't do well on Metacritic, but I chose to focus on those 5 because I found them the most interesting. But if you want me to review the worst FF games according to game FAQs, just let me know. Thank you for watching, don't forget to leave an impression, a good one if you can, and see you next time for a new exciting episode of Chocobo in Space.
There once was a ship that put to sea, and the name of the ship was the Belly of Tea. The winds blew hard, her bow dipped down, oh blow me, bully boys, blow. Soon may the wellerman come to bring us sugar and tea and rum. One day when the tonguing is done, we'll take our leave and go. Soon may the wellerman come to bring us sugar and tea and rum. One day when the tonguing is done, we'll take our leave and go.